Okay, I'm going to go ahead and get started. I do want to thank everyone for joining us. So before we get into the meat of things, I'll just introduce myself and go over a couple of ground rules and background for the Zoom meeting. My name is Matt Johnson, and I am a capital project manager with the Montgomery County Department of Transportation, and I am the project manager for this project for the Fenton Street Cycletrack Project. We do have a lot of people from our consultants and also from County DOT and the Montgomery County Planning Department who are with us here this evening. We're going to skip introductions of those people for now, but when we get to breakout groups, the people who are facilitating the breakout groups will introduce themselves to you at that time. So before we get into the presentation, I do want to go over a couple of basic controls to make sure that you are able to use the Zoom meeting. And I do want to note that this meeting is being recorded. So if you do not wish to have your face or your voice recorded, please make sure you keep your camera off and you do not speak during the portion of the meeting. If you're not comfortable speaking, you can use the chat feature to send questions to the staff. And I am going to ask not to chat at me because I'm going to be presenting and will not be looking at the chat, but we do have a colleague who will be able to answer questions. So you are all on mute and you do not have the ability to unmute yourselves right now because of the until we get to the breakout groups. So once we get to breakout groups, I will enable you to be able to unmute yourself. But for now, if you would like to speak, you can raise your hand using the raise hand feature. But we're going to have a question and answer period at the end of the presentation. So I would ask that you would just bear with us until we get to that point. If you've dialed in using a telephone, you can dial *6 to unmute yourself. But again, you will not be able to do that right now. We are asking you to keep your video cameras off in order to reduce bandwidth for people who are joining us. So please keep your video cameras off. If you have a question, you can send it via the chat feature. You should see a chat icon at the bottom, or if you're using a different version of Zoom, it may be elsewhere, but find the chat option. And then when you select who you're sending it to, send those chats to Kyle Lucas. Kyle Lucas will be handling chat questions for us this evening, and you should find his name near the top of the list since he is technically the meeting host. So again, my name is Matt Johnson. You can see my contact information here, matt.johnson@montgomerycountymd.gov. That's the easiest way to reach me. We also have a project webpage. If you would like to scan this QR code with your phone, that will take you directly to the project webpage. You can also type in the URL that you see on your screen. And don't worry, I will display this again at the end of the presentation. So if you don't have a chance to scan it now, you'll have a chance later on in the presentation. Tonight, we are going to go over some background. If you've been involved in this project over the past couple of months, a lot of this is going to be a refresher for you. But if you're new to the project, welcome. I'm glad you're interested. We'll be talking about kind of how we got to where we are today and what's going on with the project. We're then going to go into some more detail about alternative E, which is the selected alternative for this project. We'll talk about next steps, and then we're going to go to breakout sessions. We're going to have about 20 minutes for you to discuss the area of the project that you're interested in, and then we'll have a report back, and then we'll have a general question and answer period that's sort of an open floor for everyone. So in terms of why we're here tonight, the purpose of this meeting is to update you on the project and to provide you an opportunity to provide some feedback to us about the initial design plans, the concept plans for alternative E. We want to get your feedback because this is how we're going to tailor this project to meet your needs. You're the people who live in this corridor or work in this corridor or own businesses in this corridor. So it's really important for us to hear from you about what you would like to see changed about this initial concept as we get into the design process. So we want to try and keep the breakout groups small. So in order to kind of gauge where people's interests lie, we're going to start a poll question now. If you're unable to answer the poll question, or if you have any trouble answering it, or if you change your mind later, that's okay. This is just kind of a straw poll. But Kyle, if you could, I think you should be able to launch that poll question for us. We're going to ask you if you'd like to go to the breakout group talking about Fenton Village, which is the area from Gist Avenue up to Wayne Avenue, downtown Silver Spring, which is the area from Wayne Avenue up to Colesville Road, or the North End, which is from Colesville Road up to Cameron Street. So just let us know where we're going to give you a minute to, or so to answer this question. And then based on that, we will try and have enough breakout groups, that you are able to have a small group that's conducive to a good discussion. Looks like most of you have voted. Okay, so I think what we're gonna do is we don't have a huge crowd tonight. We of course may have people join us, but it looks like we have about 20 people interested in the Fenton Village area. So we're just gonna have one Fenton Village breakout group. We'll also have breakout groups for downtown Silver Spring and for the North End. And we will allow you to go to those breakout groups later. So I'm gonna stop the polling now and move on with the presentation. So thank you for taking those. Let me get into the background of this project. Just before we really get into things, I wanna make sure that we're all oriented to what the project is and some related projects that are nearby. The project that we're here to discuss tonight is shown on this map in orange, and that is the Fenton Street Cycletrack Project. I have labeled the locations of Metro, of Safeway, and of Whole Foods to help orient you to what is in the area. But I wanna note that at the North End, we have a project called the Cameron to Planning Place Bikeway. This is a short connection from Cameron Street up to Planning Place using the Garage 2 property, which will help provide a connection eventually up to Montgomery Hills. That is going to be extended through the old Planning Department headquarters as part of a private development project that's currently underway. And the Cameron to Planning Place bikeway did start construction in last month. At the south end of the project, we also have in blue the Fenton Street 410 intersection project. And this is a project that is designed to rebuild the intersection of Fenton Street and Maryland 410 to make it more pedestrian friendly and safer for cyclists and pedestrians. That project will have an element that will have a cycle track on the west side from Gist Avenue down to Maryland 410, and then a shared use path from Maryland 410 down to the Metropolitan Branch Trail. So these two projects on either end will sort of be extensions or bookends to the Fenton Street project, so those are related. But we're here tonight to talk about the orange portion, which is the area from Fenton Street and Cameron Street in the north, down to Fenton Street and Gist Avenue in the south. The purpose of the cyclotrack project, we have three main purposes. The first is to improve both bicyclist and pedestrian safety in the Fenton Street corridor. While we talk about this as being a bike project, it is also very much about pedestrian safety. We also are planning to use this project to improve bicycle connectivity both within and beyond downtown Silver Spring. So it's about getting people to Silver Spring as well as getting people through Silver Spring. And we want to make sure that we're providing a very balanced transportation system along Fenton Street. So it shouldn't matter whether you're coming here by car or by bus or by bike or on foot, or if you're trying to get deliveries or goods coming into the system. We want to make sure we're balancing those needs and that everybody is able to get here safely and comfortably. In terms of what the street looks like right now, between Rotor Road and Cameron Street in the very north end, it is 48 feet wide between the curbs. That's the roadway portion, not counting the sidewalks, just the roadway portion. South of Rotor Road, it is 44 feet wide. So it's a little bit narrower in the south end than it is in the north end. And that does make it a little more challenging to fit things in, but that's the purpose of this design, is to figure out how to best balance those needs. I'm gonna kind of go through a little bit of some key elements as we regarding the project, but we went through a lot of these in much greater detail in November. So if you're interested in learning more, I would encourage you to go back to our website and look at the recording from our November meeting. And I recognize some of the names here. I know a lot of you were probably here for that meeting. In terms of parking, there are 91 on-street parking spaces on Fenton Street within the project area. And on the east-west streets that within one block of Fenton Street, there are 207 parking spaces. There are also 4,741 parking spaces available in county-owned lots and garages within one block of Fenton Street, and you can see a map of those there. We know that loading is a very critical issue in this corridor, and it takes many forms. You can see in the top picture, we have everything from big semi-trailers bringing food to Safeway to gasoline tankers delivering to the gasoline stations on Fenton Street, down to things like box trucks, and even cars and vans serve as delivery vehicles in some cases. And loading also includes passenger loading, paratransit, ride hailing apps like Uber and Lyft, But we've already spoken in person to over 40 businesses on Fenton Street over the past several months, and we are going to continue to talk to those businesses going forward. This is a conversation, and it's an evolving conversation, but we want to understand their needs. What do they need for loading? When do they get deliveries? How is the access to their property? Do they have a back door? Do they only have a front door? Lots of things that we're learning about these businesses, and we're going to continue to work with them to figure out how we can fine-tune loading. What I think is really critical is to understand that this is not going to be a one-size-fits-all approach. We're going to need to tweak this design to meet the individual needs of the businesses in this corridor. And it's not a one-time thing, because the loading needs of 2025 may be different from the loading needs of 2030 and 2035. So this is going to need to be something that evolves over time if we want to use Fenton Street effectively. So we are aware of that, and we're committed to working with the businesses here to make sure that these changes are good for business and work well for everyone and not a hindrance. In terms of parking loading impacts, the county council, when we went to the T&E committee to get the alternative selected, they did ask us to look into the possibility of adding some loading zones on the west side of the street. So that is something that we're going to be looking at as part of this design process. But that being said, this is a very constrained corridor, and there may be some challenges in finding that space. We are committed to looking into it and trying to work it out, but we don't know what we can commit to yet until we get into the design process. Our goal is always to minimize the loss of on-street parking. There is going to be some reduction in parking on-street on Fenton Street as part of this project, but our goal is to not remove any more spaces than we absolutely have to, because we know that on-street parking is really important, especially for really short trips where people are coming in to get a cup of coffee or they're only parking for a few minutes. It's really critical to have that on-street parking, but what we've heard from people is that loading is probably more important than that short-term parking, but we know that parking is really critical and we want to save as much of it as possible. We also are going to try and explore the ability to install accessible parking on street. So far in Montgomery County, we deal with accessible parking by providing it in our lots and garages off street. It's much easier to provide the spaces there. I don't believe we have installed any on street accessible parking in Montgomery County, but this is something that we're looking at as part of this corridor. I can't say for sure that it's going to work out here. It's a very constrained corridor, but we are going to investigate what it would take to do it. And the lessons that we learn here, if we're not able to install it in this corridor, the lessons that we learn from this will be taken for future projects as well, so we can continue to work toward a more accessible Montgomery County. And finally, at the Montgomery Center, which is at the very north end of the corridor at Fenton Street and Cameron Street, we are proposing to install a paratransit loading zone there. This is an office building that has a lot of medical offices in it. And as a result, there are a lot of metro access trips and other kinds of private paratransit or people who need access directly to the curb. So we're proposing to install a paratransit loading zone as part of that that area. We don't know exactly what it's going to look like yet, but we are working on that design as part of this process. In terms of transit, Fenton Street does currently carry 4 ride-on bus lines and 1 metro bus line directly on Fenton Street. There are other bus lines that cross over Fenton Street, and of course there will be a light rail station at Fenton Street and Wayne Avenue that will be opening sometime in the mid-2020s. We know that accommodating transit is going to be a critical part of this design process, and we are proposing to have several floating bus stops as part of this project. Floating bus stops, in case you're not familiar with these, are bus stops where the bus platform is not directly connected to the sidewalk, because the bikeway is between the bus platform and the sidewalk. There's one pictured here. This is located at 2nd Avenue and Colesville Road in downtown Silver Spring, a few blocks away from Fenton Street. We are installing countermeasures at our existing floating bus stops. We have installed some of them already, and we are installing more of them at our older floating bus stops. And we will be installing countermeasures at the floating bus stops on Fenton Street that will encourage cyclists to move more slowly in these areas and to encourage yielding behavior for cyclists. When I talk about countermeasures, I mean things like a speed hump, for example, at the approach to the floating bus stop. A lateral shift, like you can kind of see here that the bike lane curves a little bit. This lateral shift helps to slow down cyclists. We have flex posts located on the central line to make the bikeway feel narrower. Also, as part of the Fenton Street project, we will be co-locating our bus platforms with signals. So the bus platforms will all have at least 2 entry points. One of those entry points will be located at a signal associated with the cross street. So if you want to go to one end of the platform, you can wait, you can push the button and wait for the audible pedestrian signal, wait for the walk sign to come on. If you don't want to wait for the signal, the crosswalk at the other end of the bus platform will be uncontrolled and you can cross with the right of way. Cyclists will have to yield to you. But we are committed to continuing to work to make these as accessible as possible and to make them as safe and comfortable as possible for everyone to use. So we have been working on improving those designs. In terms of bus stops, and this presentation is going to be available on our website, so feel free to look at the PowerPoint slides in more with more a little slower pace tomorrow or the next day when the presentation is posted. But this graphic, it shows the southbound bus stops only on Fenton Street. We do not anticipate any major changes to northbound bus stops. But the reason I'm showing this graphic is really to illustrate that most of the bus stops are going to continue to be located roughly where they are now. They might have some minor relocations. We are proposing eliminating one bus stop that's located on Fenton Street, just south of Cameron Street, because that's where we're going to be putting the paratransit loading zone. That serves Route 28, and there's another stop at Cameron in Georgia, which is very close and on the same block. And then we're also proposing to consolidate the bus stops that are located at Fenton and Sligo and Fenton and Philadelphia into a single bus stop at Fenton and Gist, which you can see here at the south end of the corridor. Those are the main proposed changes for bus stops. Otherwise, the bus stops will largely remain where they are today. In terms of traffic signals, I am including the Fenton-Philadelphia intersection project as part of this graphic just to kind of show the whole length of the corridor. But from Cameron Street down to Philadelphia Avenue, there are currently 9 traffic signals. 4 of these signals are owned by the Maryland State Highway Administration. 5 of them are owned and operated by the Montgomery County Department of Transportation. We have 2 proposed hawk signals located at Fenton and Roeder and Fenton and Pershing that are part of a separate project, which we anticipate those will be installed before this project goes to construction. And we're also investigating the possibility of installing a hawk signal at Fenton Street and Gist Avenue. So you can kind of see what the signalization looks like here on a map of the corridor. We are also proposing to use bike signals on Fenton Street as part of this project. There are some hurdles to using these because federal highways rules are very strict about how bike signals can be used right now. They're currently considered what's called an interim approved device, which means they're not fully in the manual that traffic engineers use. So they're a little bit more restricted. We're proposing to conduct a request to experiment with federal highway, which would allow us to use these a little bit more liberally, but in ways that are very similar to how some other jurisdictions have been using bike signals. But essentially the way we're proposing is to have the green bike signal be displayed during a leading bike interval where cars are stopped, but bikes get an advanced green signal along with pedestrians going the same direction as bikes. And then following that the bike signal will transition to a flashing yellow bike signal during the time when drivers who are turning right are able to turn right across the bike lane. However, we are proposing that left turns across the bikeway would only be allowed on the green arrow. So when bikes have the green signal or the flashing yellow bike signal, left turning drivers would have a red arrow signal and would not be permitted to turn left. Just for reference, we have 1 bike signal in Montgomery County so far. It was installed in 2019 at Coleshill Road and 2nd Avenue. We have 4 more intersections that have had the bike signal equipment installed, but they're not yet activated. Those are all in downtown Bethesda. And we have, I know that the slide presentation said we have a 5th one anticipated in the fall. We actually have 2 more anticipated to be installed this fall. So we're gonna be going from 1 to 7 in the span of this year. But Fenton will have additional ones. I also wanna point out that we got a grant from the Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments to do a study and create a pilot design for bringing best practices in wayfinding and safety for people who have vision disabilities to Montgomery County. So this grant that we've been working on for the past about 7 months, and it's a really exciting project. I've been really excited to work with our commission on people with disabilities and other stakeholders in the area about how we can make Silver Spring and Montgomery County easier to navigate for people who are blind or have low vision. So the pilot design, the pilot intersection design is actually on this corridor. It's at Fenton and Ellsworth, and the recommendations from that pilot design are going to be incorporated into this larger project and will be constructed as part of the Fenton Street project. But one of the, I think, coolest things that we're doing is the tactile graphics, which you can see pictured here. What you'll note from this, the pictures, the one on top shows a close-up of the tactile intersection graphic of Fenton Street and Ellsworth. And you can see that the bike lane is texturized so that a blind person can put their fingers on the bike lane and follow it through the intersection. The roadway is actually depressed on the graphics from the sidewalk, and the roadway is also textured differently from the sidewalk, so people can feel where different things are. So what's really exciting about this is we're finding new ways to engage people who can't traditionally engage with our paper plans, that might not have the accessibility features that they need to participate in the process. So throughout the Fenton Street project, we are going to be developing these 3D tactile graphics. So the next time we meet, I'm hopeful that we can have an in-person meeting and I can see all of your faces again. And when that happens, when you come to that meeting, we will have a 3D graphic for people who are not able to see the paper plans. So we're really excited to be working on elements like that. And if you're interested in learning more about that project, the link is here at the bottom of this slide. But if you're interested, you can reach out to me directly and I will email you the link to that. And this graphic actually shows the pilot intersection design. So this is a little bit more advanced than the rest of the project because of the grant funding. We're going to be incorporating these recommendations into the larger Fenton Street project. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here to save time, but what you can see here is we're proposing, in addition to the traditional detectable warning surfaces, the truncated domes that you see at crosswalks, we're proposing guidance surfaces that will help people who have vision disabilities find things like the audible pedestrian signal, or find the crosswalk, stay within the crosswalk. We're only going to install these features at the Fenton and Ellsworth intersection, and we're going to observe how they work. But if these are successful here, or if they need to be tweaked, we'll do those tweaks, and then we will try and roll these out in other parts of the county that have critical needs for or difficulties for people who have vision disabilities to navigate. And finally, I want to talk a little bit about stormwater management and the urban environment. We want this to be a best practices kind of project, not just for accessibility, but also for stormwater management. The pictures you see here, the top right picture shows a cyclotrack that was built in Oakland, California. The one on the bottom left shows Lincoln, Nebraska. And what you can see in both of these projects is they have incorporated stormwater management into the design. So in the Oakland example, it's between the bikeway and the sidewalk. In the Lincoln example, it's between the bike lane and the parking lane. Our corridor is a little bit more constrained than these corridors, but we want to bring in treatment types like this throughout the corridor, which will help bring some more greenery to downtown Silver Spring, and which will also very importantly treat the stormwater the rainwater that falls in downtown Silver Spring. What you may not realize is that when it rains in Silver Spring, like it did last night, or like it did a little bit this morning, that water that falls on the street goes into catch basins and it just goes through pipes directly to our waterways. So every drop of rain that falls on Fenton Street goes directly to Sligo Creek. And a lot of times it carries things like motor oil and other pollutants, other litter, directly to our waterways, which eventually make their way to the Potomac River and the Chesapeake Bay. So treating that water using facilities like this before it gets to our storm drain system is a key way to help protect the environment. And we want Fenton Street to be a part of that solution. Now with that, I'm going to go into some detail on alternative B before we get to our breakout sessions. And I do want to talk a little bit about the different features that you'll see as part of the alternative E part of Fenton Street. What you can see is that there'll be on-street parking on the east side of the street. We're going to have on-street loading areas on the east side of the street. We're also looking at where we can incorporate them on the west side or on the east-west streets to the west of Fenton Street. There will be a 5 feet or wider sidewalk throughout the length of the project, and I do want to emphasize wider as much as possible, but it will always be at least 5 feet wide. And we are going to do things to try and maximize accessibility, making sure that they're as direct as possible, making sure they're free of obstructions as possible. There will be a two-way bikeway on the west side of Fenton Street, and there will be a raised barrier separating the bikeway from traffic. Now, that in some places it may just be as simple as a raised concrete curb. In other locations, it may take the form of stormwater management like we saw on the previous slide. There will be some floating bus stops, which I already discussed earlier in the presentation. And we are proposing to install corner island treatments or protected intersection treatments at as many of the intersections as possible. You can see in the very bottom picture here an image from the 2nd Avenue Spring Street intersection, which was Montgomery County's first protected intersection. And our corner islands are going to look a little bit different One of the things that we learned from that project was that we needed to have a little bit more of a gradual transition for cyclists. So they're going to be a little bit more smooth to transition into, but they will still serve the purpose, which is to reduce the turning speeds of vehicles, improve sight lines for drivers, cyclists, and pedestrians, and to reduce the exposure of pedestrians and cyclists. So basically, when you cross the street, the amount of time you're exposed to traffic is called the exposure. By putting these corner islands in, we reduce the exposure. We reduce the length of time when you're at risk of being struck by a vehicle. And by slowing down those turns, we increase the likelihood that drivers will be able to avoid collision. But if there is a collision, that lower speed is directly correlated with better crash survivability and reduced injury. As I go through the alternative, I just want to kind of orient you and point out that in these images, north is to the right, not up, but to the right. Georgia Avenue is running left to right off the top of the screen. Grove Street is running left to right off the bottom of the screen. Montgomery College will be off to the left. Downtown Silver Spring is off to the right. With that, I'm going to talk just a little bit more general about the alternative E. We're not proposing any major widening in downtown Silver Spring. There will be some widening at the intersections to accommodate the corner islands. This alternative, compared to the other alternatives, prioritizes left turn protection for cyclists and moving vehicles over parking in some cases. But basically what that means is at most intersections, there will be a northbound left turn lane, and left turns will be restricted to turning on the green arrow only, which will protect cyclists and pedestrians from left turns. We are not proposing to have southbound left turn lanes at most intersections. Some of them may still get left turn lanes. That's something that we want to hear from you about. If you have ideas of where we should have left turn lanes for southbound traffic, that would be really helpful. And the reason we're eliminating those southbound left turn lanes is to preserve a little bit of parking on those blocks. And then parking will be on the east side only, not on the west side. I've talked about some of these features already, but I'm going to kind of work from left to right and just point out what you're seeing here. We have a cycle track on the west side of the street. We have the left turn lane here. We have a floating bus stop. You can see that we've installed side street bump outs, meaning we're reducing the exposure on the side streets. This is a corner island here. We're showing the loading zones with this sort of pink shading. I want to point out that the loading zones are conceptual locations only. We're going to work with the businesses and the residents here to determine exactly where those loading zones need to be. We haven't finalized those locations. We're just showing them sort of conceptually now. And then you can see the parking is located on the east side of the street here. So starting at the south end of the corridor, one of the changes that I've already mentioned is this bus stop here at Sligo Avenue is going to be moved down one block to Gist Avenue. It's a very short block. And this will allow us to consolidate this stop with a stop at Philadelphia Avenue. And you can see here, we have a northbound left turn lane approaching Sligo Avenue. You can see corner island treatments. These are all pretty standard. I'm not gonna necessarily call them out every single slide, but this is just to kind of get you oriented here. And we will have these available to look at in the breakout sessions as well. As we move a little bit further north here, you can see Silver Spring Avenue. Just for reference, this is the Italian Kitchen here on the bottom right of this intersection, and the Cafe Le Sac here on the upper right corner. We're still preserving the sidewalk cafe here. It does get a little tight, so we may need to examine exactly how this corner is laid out. As we move a little bit further north, we can get to the intersection where we have Safeway here on the upper right and Exxon on the lower right here. We are proposing to move the bus stop to the far side of the intersection because we don't have enough room to make an accessible stop on this side given the Safeway garage entrance. And this would mean that the Route 28 would get a new stop after it turns onto Thayer Avenue. Up here at Bonifon Street, you can see the floating bus stop here that permits direct connection to the Purple Line light rail station at Silver Spring Library. I will note that Bonifon Street between Georgia Avenue and Fenton Street will be one-way eastbound when the Purple Line opens. So we don't need a left turn lane northbound at this intersection. Once we get up here to Wayne Avenue, I know this intersection is just very roughly laid out. This is not exactly what it's going to look like. And this crosswalk does not need to be nearly as skewed as it is. It's just a quick layout. We are showing the bike lane having a little zigzag here because we want cyclists to cross the light rail tracks at as close to a right angle as possible to avoid the risk of having their wheels stuck in the flangeway. That being said, this intersection will have what are called flangeway fillers. These are little rubber gaskets essentially that make it so it's pretty flush. And when the light rail train runs over them, the gaskets get flat so that the train can stay on the tracks. but it does reduce the risk of crashes for cyclists. This area immediately north of Wayne Avenue is somewhere where we're looking at. We did not show left turn lane as part of the alternative E plan, but we are investigating whether we need to have a left turn lane here, which would be at the expense of these parking spaces. That's being examined. We're also evaluating what this lay-by for the courtyard by Marionette will look like. You can also see where this proposed hawk signal at Pershing or the Whole Foods roadway there. That's a part of a separate project, but we are assuming that it will be installed before this project is constructed. As we move north to to Ellsworth Drive and Rotor Road, this is the area where you saw the graphic for the pilot design earlier. So I'm just gonna kind of breeze past that, but we do have another proposed hawk signal at Rotor Road. Once we get to Colesville, we have, again, this area is under study. Do we need to have a left turn lane here or a right turn lane here? We're looking at how this lane configuration is gonna work in the design. That's something that we're gonna work out through the design process. And then finally, once we get up here to the north end, this area is just very conceptually showing the paratransit loading zone. It's gonna look different than this. This was just kind of a placeholder, but there will be a space for vehicles to pull out of the way of traffic so they won't block traffic when they're loading here. You can also kind of see the protected intersection here at Cameron and Fenton that is being constructed as part of the Cameron to Planning Place flyway, which is currently under construction. So that's the alternative from south to north. I'm just going to quickly go through some next steps before we get to the breakout groups. So we're almost there. I know it's a lot of information, but just bear with me. We're almost done with the presentation part. Just to quickly recap, we have the two other projects in the north and the south. We have the Cameron to Planning Place bikeway in purple here, which is under construction and will open this year. In red, you can see the portion of that project that will go through the old planning department headquarters site. That's probably going to open by the end of 2023. It's being built by developers, so we don't know exactly when it's going to open, but we think 2023 is reasonable. And then at the south end, the Maryland 410 intersection project, we are planning to construct that next year in 2022. And then in green here, you can see the Metropolitan Branch Trail. This piece of the trail is already constructed and open. It goes from King Street down to the border with the District of Columbia. And then you can see in orange the project that we're here to talk about tonight. Right now, we are anticipating building phase one from Gist Avenue to Bonifon Street. The reason that we're proposing this as phase one is because it does not involve crossing any state highways. When we have state highways, it does extend our permitting process timeline, so that generally adds several months to our design and permitting process. So as a result, we're proposing to design all this at once, but then build phase one while we're still working on getting permits for phase two, which would take us across three state highways because Bonifon Street, Wayne Avenue, and Colesville Road are all state highways. And so our proposal is to build phase one around 2023 and phase two around 2024. This is contingent on getting funding, additional funding in the capital improvement program. So just in terms of meetings, I know that we've been very engaged with you as part of this process. These kinds of meetings are what helps us get good feedback from you. So we have lots more of them scheduled. Our last meeting is not shown on this slide, but our last meeting was in November of last year. The design effort started last month, and where you can see in bold there, we're having a community meeting in June right now. That's the meeting you're at now. Once we get to 30% design, which we anticipate will be in the fall of this year, we will have another community meeting followed by a mandatory referral hearing at the planning board, which is also open to the public. Once we get to 65% design, which we expect will be in early 2022, we'll have another community meeting. And finally, at 90% design, which will be in late 2022, we'll have one more community meeting to kind of brief you on where the design is and give you one final opportunity to request changes or design tweaks to the project. And then we are shooting, as I said before, for construction in 2023 for phase one and 2024 for phase two. In terms of the schedule, you can see the studies, which if you've been involved in this process, some of you have been involved since the beginning. We started way back in 2017. We completed the study at the end of 2020. In early 2021, the alternative was selected. We're now in the design phase, which again, I mentioned 30%, 65%, 90% design meetings. We anticipate getting to 100% design or final design around the end of 2022. Permitting will start before we finish design. Permitting usually starts around 90% design, so permitting can take a few months. There may be the need to relocate utilities. That can start before construction. It can sometimes start even before permitting is completed. So it would be, of course, two different elements of utility work for the different phases. but we would anticipate that utility work could start as early as the beginning of 2023. And then you can see the construction for phases one and phase two in the summer of 2023 and 2024 respectively. But I do want to note that construction timing is contingent on getting additional funding in the capital budget. So depending on when the capital budget allocates that money, will impact when the construction can happen. But this is our anticipated schedule for right now and what we're currently operating under these assumptions. I know another thing that people have been concerned about are construction impacts. I know that Fenton Street has been a construction zone for 3 years. It's been very disruptive construction. This work was being done by Pepco as part of a major undergrounding project for underground transmission lines. What I can assure you is that our construction is not going to be nearly as long or nearly as disruptive as that Pepco work. Most of our work happens at the surface. Our construction timeline is somewhere in the area of 3 to 4 months, we think. And it's not like we're going to be in front of your business for 3 months or in front of your door for 4 months. We kind of work in stages. So we'll do all the storm drain work starting at one end and kind of working through the project. We come back and do the curb work, come back and do the sidewalk work, come back and do the paving and other things. There will be a county inspector on site at all times during construction, and we will distribute his or her phone number liberally amongst the businesses and residents near here, so that if you see a problem, you can call that number and we can have an inspector there to deal with your issue within a few minutes. We are also going to work very closely with the businesses related, especially related to any issues with access. The pictures you see here on the right are actually from construction that's currently underway in Bethesda on the Capitol Crescent Trail. This is just to give you a sense of kind of how the construction, we're not talking about a full depth reconstruction of everything. It's much more limited. And I'll give you an example. We had a business where we needed to reconstruct the driveway apron as part of our work. And we went to the business owner and we said, we need to reconstruct your driveway apron. When's a good time for you? Typically we work Monday through Fridays. And they said, well, usually Saturdays and Sundays would be good for us. But this weekend, we actually have a new tenant moving in and we're getting a furniture delivery on Saturday. So is there any way you can not do it this week? And we said, absolutely. And we moved the construction to the next weekend on a Saturday when they didn't have any deliveries. We worked with them. We're going to be flexible. We understand that the businesses are the lifeblood of Fenton Village, and we are going to work with you to make sure that these disruptions are not going to kill your business or create undue hardship. All right, with that, we're going to get ready to go to the breakout sessions. We are only going to have 3 breakout sessions. So Kyle, if you're listening and you're setting up the breakout sessions, we're just going to have, you can delete the second Fenton Village session. We have a small enough group that we're just going to have one of those. The breakout sessions are going to go for about 20 minutes. So we're going to break, we're going to come back here about 7:30. And after the breakout sessions, we're going to have a report back session. And then after that, we'll have a question and answer period and a comment period for general comments. So if you have a concern about a part of the project in a different area, so let's say you pick Fenton Village, but you're also concerned about something at the north end of Silver Spring, you can hold that thought. We can bring it up in the main session if it doesn't get brought up in the report back period. Just etiquette for Zoom, if you're in the breakout rooms, please keep yourself muted unless you're actively speaking so we don't get any background noise. If there's a lot of people talking, you may want to use the raise hand feature so that the moderator can call on you. But if it's quieter and no one else is talking, it's okay if you don't have to raise your hand. In just a minute, you're going to have the ability to pick the room you want to go to. And I do want to point out that at the top right here, we have a QR code. This will take you directly to the alternative E PDF plans, which are on our website. So we're going to have those available through shared screen, but if you would like to see them yourself, you can scan that QR code and that will take you directly to those plans. Anything you want to talk about related to the Fenton Street project is fair game, but what we would find really helpful is if you could kind of try and work on answering some of these focus questions. So for example, we want to hear, how do you use Fenton Street today? And how do you think it might change with the proposal that you've seen tonight? What are you prioritizing for Fenton Street? So what do you think the most important part of Fenton Street is? And where do you see Fenton Street 10 years from now or 20 years from now? Where do you see things going? Do you have any intersections in particular that you are concerned about? Places where you see that there are problems or things you would like to see the design be changed about? Are there areas where you know that loading is a really important issue? Are there areas where you constantly see vehicles, you know, blocking parking spaces or blocking the roadway? Those are areas that we want to hear about. Is there anything about this project that you've seen tonight that you don't like? We want to hear about that. If there's anything you think is missing from alternative E, we want to hear about that. That's really, really helpful. And if there's anything you would like to see change about alternative E, we would like to hear that as well. So this constructive feedback will be really helpful for us in tweaking the design so that when we come back to you in a couple months, the design should better reflect your needs and your desires as part of this project. So we're going to go to the breakout sessions now. If you want to talk about Fenton Village, you don't have to do anything. You can stay right here in this room. We're just going to talk about Fenton Village in the main room. If you want to talk about downtown Silver Spring, when the breakout sessions open, you can select downtown Silver Spring, and we'll also have a north end Silver Spring area. So if downtown is between Wayne Avenue and Colesville Road, the north end is between Colesville Road and Cameron Street. If you need live captioning, we will have live captioning in this room and also in the downtown Silver Spring room. So if you want to talk about the north end, but you need captioning, just go to the downtown room and we can deal with your questions there. And so with that, Kyle, if you can open the breakout rooms, people can then choose their rooms.
Real quick, Matt, I think we're doing these for 25 minutes. Is that
what? 20 minutes. So about, let's say 7:35, we'll come back to the main room.
Okay. I'll go ahead and open these up.
All right, so I want to thank everyone for participating in the breakout sessions. I know we still have quite a few hands up, so we're going to get to the question and answer session in a few minutes. So if you want to keep your hand up, it's just a virtual hand, so your arm's not going to get tired. That's the good news. So we'll get to the questions in a minute. And with that, I'm going to go to report back. So let's start with the downtown Silver Spring group. I think, Pat, you were the note taker there. Can you give us a report back?
Sure.
And let's try and keep you about 5 minutes or less.
Okay. Question number one of some of the concerns was that there were so many small businesses, but in order to actually patronize those businesses, it would be helpful to have ample and convenient bike parking, and where those cluster of businesses are located would be, the best location. Someone else said that perhaps we could swap out bike parking for a parking space, as we have done in some other locations. David responded that this is a conceptual plan level, and we will go ahead and investigate that. Someone else said they love to walk along Fenton, but they're without the protected bike lane, they're not going to bike there. So the protected bike lane with the curb barriers are important to him and his family. Someone else said, I love walking along Fenton, but I hate cycling. Cars come within 6 inches of my elbow, even when I'm on my electric bike. I can go 23 miles per hour, but then cars are going 25 and I'm still in that situation. So in terms of priorities, we had a blind individual who feels uncomfortable particularly at the intersection of Ellsworth and Fenton. He has already provided us with much information, Matt, and he has received some input from MCDOT, but particularly at the corner of Ellsworth and Fenton, there are a number of buskers who are performing, and the volume there can be ridiculous. He has to depend on his hearing, and it's very stressful when he can't hear other sounds. Perhaps one consideration would be to close the entire stretch of Ellsworth. It's currently closed between Ellsworth and Georgia, but perhaps the whole stretch could be considered as a closed pedestrian space. Bicyclists should try to be more courteous. Sometimes they're not friendly to pedestrians and do not follow the traffic laws as they should. And specifically at the floating bus stops, it could be a very fearful place for just people with disabilities, and we should take into consideration not only visually impaired, but people with other mobility issues, and perhaps we could work on some type of an education campaign or public service announcement where we're educating all users, because you know, we're all sharing the same space and should be aware of those that have hearing loss or mobility issues as well as those visually impaired. And one last comment was on Wayne Avenue and Purple Line crossing. Did we explore the other side? And you know, there's a, so perhaps you should look at that location again on why you're switching sides. Did I cover everything in our group, or David, would you like to add anything?
The only other comment that I recall hearing was about additional signing for visually impaired folks, because sometimes bicyclists are aware of pedestrians, but they're not exactly always looking for pedestrians that are using canes or wheelchairs or other types of mobility equipment.
Yeah, thank you.
Great, thanks, Pat. Let's do the North End group next. I think, Kyle, you were the note taker in that group.
Yeah, I took some notes. Let me go ahead and pull that up. So we had a little smaller group than the other ones, and had a few kind of good questions come across. So we had some questions about parking and whether, you know, so we've got majority of the parking on the north side, and some questions about loading zones on the south side, and in particular, just kind of some concern about trucks kind of pulling in and out, having to straddle the bike lanes. In particular, we looked at Montgomery Center, which is a medical building, and there was the suggestion to have a few handicap spots there in order to help facilitate access for those with disabilities. We also had some questions on green paint and if there's been any improvements and how that sticks to the pavement. We talked a little bit about the intersection of Cameron and Fenton and how that's just kind of a weird intersection and pretty unpredictable from, you know, for cars. And talked a little bit about how the new kind of planning place connector should hopefully help with that a little bit. Some discussion on where the scope of work kind of ends at the curb and gutter. So if there's a stretch of curb and gutter that's in poor shape, is that going to be replaced? We also talked a little bit about utility access points and whether, you know, those are going to kind of be addressed. So for example, if there's a manhole cover that's maybe sticking out a little bit, or maybe a grate that might make things difficult for bicyclists, whether that would be, you know, addressed through this. And then the last thing was just a suggestion to, at some point, conduct some walking sessions. And while it's very beneficial to have the access of a virtual meeting, it might be helpful for some to actually walk the corridor and take a closer look at that. So that was kind of the what came up for our group here.
Great, thanks, Kyle. There was one more. I had to, just for everyone's, since you weren't all in the North End group, we had some trouble with our captions in the downtown group, so I apologize for that. And I had to go find Kyle to see if he could resolve that issue, so I replaced him as note taker at the end of the North End group. And I think we basically had one more comment, which was a question about whether we were going to have an integrated wayfinding plan for cyclists in downtown Silver Spring. And the answer to that is, we absolutely are going to do that. We wanted to build out a little bit more of the network first before we started putting in wayfinding signs, but that is part of, and also particularly including some branding as part of that as well to help name some of the bike routes that are continuous. So that's the answer to that question. And then for the Fenton Village group, I forget who was the note taker. Was it Katie or
Andy? Yeah, I gotcha.
Great. Thank you, Katie.
No sweat. Happy to. Okay. So we had a lot of dialogue, actually. It was really good. So the first question was asking about existing curb cuts, and are there any plans, or are we exploring any opportunities to close those because they create breaks in that separation between the cyclists and the motor vehicle traffic? Matt, you answered that we're not planning to close any existing curb cuts because those provide accesses to the buildings and the businesses, but we are exploring ways to mitigate them with pavement markings, signage, and in fact, there's been a treatment that was applied in Bethesda on Bethesda Avenue that created a speed table at the driveway. So it almost creates like a speed bump for the car to get up and over. So it slows them down and makes them very cautious as they're entering that space. There was a question about a bus stop that's located at Thayer and Fenton that is being moved. There was especially concern about the circulator stop. And so it was discussed that the bus stop is going to get moved to the opposite side of the street for the other bus lines, but the circulator is actually going to be relocated to Thayer, which may actually serve the uses a little bit better. Matt, does that capture your point on that?
Okay. I'm nodding yes, I was muted.
Okay, yeah. I know, it's so hard to get out of the habit. We've been doing this for a year and still, like, yeah. Okay, great. Then another question is, when Fenton Street Bikeway is realized, will people using micro-mobility devices, such as motor scooters, use the bike lanes or use the sidewalks? And we got into a bit of a discussion about the current codes and laws. And the truth of the matter is, motor, like scooters and mopeds are technically allowed in the bike lanes. And that's kind of where we all assume they're going to be because it's going to be this new designated facility that's not going to be crowded with pedestrians. But technically, bicyclists can continue to use the sidewalk even if the bikeway is installed. So there was some question about whether or not changing the law would happen at a county level or at the state, and we're not sure, so we'll need to figure that out. All right, there was another question about efforts to reduce, there was a question about why are we investigating a designated facility on Fenton when Grove Street, as it stands right now, is a more comfortable facility and it's just one street over? And this is where really we got into some dialogue amongst the participants in our group. So Matt, first you answered and explained that Grove is less direct and it requires some turns. And we've also done counts on Fenton Street that shows there is a demand there. Another point that you made was that the Bicycle Master Plan envisions bike accommodations on both. Certainly the signed route along Grove has its own purpose. It's very low volume with motor vehicles and it's a comfortable place for bicyclists to be, but perhaps when you're commuting north and south either to DC or other places in Silver Spring, Fenton is probably the more direct and comfortable way to go. So having some redundancy in the network is good. There was some concern about taking away turn lanes. There's already some restrictions for at turning red on right signals the reason why this came up is that it's contributing to congestion. And Matt explained that we're aware of this issue and we're looking at different ways to address congestion where turning lanes can't fit. So for example, maybe it makes sense to ban left turn lanes during certain hours at certain places. There can also be split phases of the signal, some through left options. So certainly we're looking to, as best we can, address not making any additional congestion. And then there was another question as to whether or not bike volumes have changed since bike lanes were installed on Second Avenue. And I think the implied question was, you know, is this going to be worth it? And we have seen elsewhere in the county where the connections are really important, like on Spring Street in Silver Spring or on Wood Glen, that yes, indeed, we do see high demands where those connections are really needed. And then the last question, I'll end it with, someone asked about some concerns with the designated loading areas. Matt, you characterized in the presentation kind of how this is an issue for businesses, but it was remarked that this is also an issue for residents because residents have needs for loading, whether it's they're moving into their unit or they're just, you know, they have a lot of groceries or they're, you know, unpacking from a big trip or a furniture, like this is a need. And so there was sort of an emphasis to make sure that passenger vehicles may be able to use them as well and, you know, preserve them and designate them where we can fit them. I think that's it.
Well, great. Thank you, Katie and Pat and Kyle for doing the report back. So we have about 40 minutes left in this meeting and we don't have to use all of it if we don't have discussion, but I'm sure that this crowd has a lot to say. We do have some hands up. So I am going to go to the questions and discussion. I did promise you that link would come back. So if you want to find the project website, you can scan that QR code or type in that URL there. This PowerPoint and the video of this meeting will be posted to our website the PowerPoint hopefully will get posted tomorrow. The meeting will take a couple of days because we have to get it closed captioned, make sure everything, all the captions are in appropriately and working. But that will be posted. So if you missed it, or if you have friends who couldn't attend and you want to get the whole story, you can watch the video. With that, I am going to start going to the questions and discussions. So anything you want to bring up that's related to Fenton Street is fair game. And it looks like Dan Reed, you are the next person. I'm going to ask you to unmute yourself.
Hi. I don't have much to say. I'm Dan Reed. I live in East Silver Spring. I'm vice president of the East Silver Spring Citizens Association, but I'm just here speaking for myself. Generally, I just wanted to say I'm really happy with all the hard work that y'all have done to balance, I think, what are a lot of competing needs here, particularly in regards to the business community. And I also want to really, I really appreciate the gentleman who mentioned loading for residents as well. I think, you know, and this is my personal experience as well as someone who lives next to Fenton Street, that a lot of the parking needs are for very short trips, whether it's somebody being dropped off or picked up, or somebody running in a store to pick up something, or a delivery driver going in to pick something up. And I'm glad that we can have spaces set aside for that. And I wonder if y'all know whether those space, if there's a decision right now about whether the parking on Fenton Street will still remain for like 1 hour or 2 hour parking, or if there's going to be a chance to do shorter term parking for those little quick trips, so that people who need to pull up in front of a store have empty spaces to do that, and those who are coming to stay for longer can park in one of the garages or lots just off the street.
That's an excellent question, Dan. I can't answer it right now. That is something that we're going to have to work through over the next 2 years as we go through the design process. And my understanding is that that may also require, changing the duration may require council legislation. So we may have to work through this as part of a larger process. That was something that was recommended by the planning staff when this went to mandatory referral to planning board, was that we should try and focus on using Fenton Street for really short-term spaces, and that longer trips, like if you're coming down for dinner, that maybe you should park in a garage rather than just running in to get a coffee or something. That's something that we're going to look at, and that's really great feedback, and we want to hear from you. If you live in this neighborhood, or you work in this neighborhood, or you shop or own a business in this neighborhood, over the next, you know, several months, several years, as we work through this process, we're going to work on issues like that and try and get it right. So that may mean, you know, when do we have the meter hours? You know, do we need to extend the meter hours? One of the things that we heard earlier on in the process was that the meters stop at, I believe, 6 p.m. and people come home and park on the street and just go home, and they leave their car there over from 6 p.m. until 7 a.m. the next morning. And that means that people who are coming for restaurants or whatnot don't have access to those spaces. So that was one of the things we heard from business owners, was, is there some way we can try and still keep that turnover happening later in the evening? So there's a lot that we need to look at. Some of that may require council action, but it certainly is going to require coordinating with my division, which is the Division of Transportation Engineering, our Division of Parking Management, and other residents and businesses in the area. So thank you for that comment, Dan. It's something we're going to keep looking at. I believe Martin Postumus has got his hand up next, so you should be able to unmute yourself, Martin.
Hi there. So first of all, let me just say I'm really glad to see this moving forward, and I can't wait until it's actually there and ready to use. My question had to do with turning maneuvers for bikes. Looking at the plans, well, because Fenton Street has lots of businesses on both sides of the street, and so naturally you're going to be seeing a lot of people coming from the cycle track who are going to want to make a turning maneuver across Fenton Street to get to the other side of the street, or just to turn across Fenton. And I don't see in these plans anything like bike boxes or something along those lines. And I'm just wondering what sort of turning maneuver is going to be encouraged in these designs for people trying to get from the cycle track across Fenton Street.
That's a great question, Martin. These were very conceptual plans, so they don't have nearly the level of detail that we will eventually have. What we will be using for these for turning movements is likely to be the two-stage turn boxes, which are present on both Second Avenue and on Spring Street, Cedar Street. So we have those turning boxes. So there'll be a designated place for cyclists who wish to turn. And basically the way those work is you're biking on the cycle track, and let's say you want to turn left at one of the cross streets, and you're going down Fenton Street and you have the green bike signal. Once you get into the intersection, you kind of pull out of the stream of bike traffic and move into a protected area where there's a green box painted on the roadway, and you wait there. And then when the light turns green for the perpendicular street, the side street, let's just say, for example, for Thayer Avenue, when that light turns green, you're in front of all the cars and you get to be the first person to go through the intersection. So it's called a two-stage cue box because it requires two stages, two different signal phases to make that turn. It's very similar to how a pedestrian turns, right? A pedestrian crosses one leg and then waits to cross the second leg when they're turning left at an intersection. So these will be two turning boxes for both left turns and right turns. If you're going northbound and you want to turn right or left, southbound and turn left, they'll be both direction turn boxes. That's what we're currently thinking of. But if you have other ideas for how we should accommodate those turns, we would love to hear those. And you can feel free to email me. My email address is on the slide, and I'll read it out in case you can't read the slides. My email address is matt.johnson@montgomerycountymd.gov. So anyone who wants to email me, please feel free to reach out with comments. Was that your only question, Martin? And I have you've muted yourself again, so you may not be able to unmute yourself, but if you're done, you can lower your hand, and if you have another question, keep it up. Okay, great. Next up, we have Stefan Babich. I am asking you to unmute right now.
Hello, thanks. I'm also a resident on Fenton Street at the Lofts, and this question sort of ties into the other question that was made earlier about resident parking, but I had a question specifically about longer-term parking for moving trucks. When I moved in, we had to reserve a parking space on the west side of Fenton Street for a couple of hours for the truck, and I just wasn't sure if any thought had been given to where residents could put a moving truck close enough to move like lots of heavy things like furniture to and from the truck when they're moving in or out of the building.
Yeah, that's a great question, Stefan. We mainly focused on businesses for loading, but I think this is we've heard from a few of you that we need to focus also on the residential buildings that are right on Fenton Street. So that's something that we're going to need to take a look at. Not something we can answer today, but we have a long time ahead of us before this project is designed. So we may have a loading zone on Bonifant Street instead, which could be effective for that, or we may need to try and find a way to fit in a loading zone on the west side of Fenton Street, which the council has asked us to take a look at trying to do. So different options, we're gonna take a look at that. And I want you to hold us accountable. I want you to come to the 30% meeting this fall and tell us if we've done a good job for you. So that's—
All right, thanks. I'm just calling us on the radar.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. And go ahead and lower your hand, and I'm gonna call on Zach Weinstein. Go ahead, Zach. Zachary, I should say, Zachary Weinstein, go ahead.
Hey, so I was wondering, since it seems like these plans, which I agree seem great, but it seems like they'll take a while, and I was wondering what we could do to make these roads safer in the shorter term, whether there's anything less permanent. For example, if we plan to close the high-speed on-ramps at the south end of Fenton Street, could we close them off now just with traffic cones or, the big, the more the barrel-like traffic cones that you'll see, on to part the road for construction?
Yeah, we are certainly interested in making tactical changes to our roadways like that, but they're not always easy to do. In the case of Fenton and Maryland 410, the big challenge we have there is that for larger vehicles, the geometry doesn't work well. The ramp works great, but if we close that ramp, the intersection is kind of at an odd angle, and it would be very difficult for a large truck to actually be able to navigate that turn. So closing that right turn ramp has to happen when we make other changes to the intersection to make that the through lane have enough radius to allow larger trucks to turn. So there may be other opportunities to use tactical treatments, and that's kind of what you're going to see very soon on Grove Street. We're going to be installing some painted paint and flex post bump outs on the side streets to kind of reduce the exposure and make people turn a little more slowly. DC has done a lot of that, if you're familiar with some of DC's traffic calming. There are some opportunities for us to do that, but at that particular intersection, the geometry is a little too challenging to make that work. But I wish it was easier, and that's a project that we really hope that will get built next year. So we're really getting close to the finish line on that one, I think. And another year, and I know it's a long time to wait sometimes, but we are working actively to try and get that worked on. Okay. Is that your only question?
Actually, I also wanted to ask whether MCDOT was considering any automated enforcement treatments on Fenton Street as a part of this plan. I liked the idea of limiting the hours that vehicles can make left turns. I think that would go a long way toward making walking and biking safer on Fenton Street. But I know that those rules are often ignored, or you know, it can be confusing because you know maybe a driver doesn't realize that left-hand turns are not allowed. So I'm a big fan of red light cameras and speed cameras, and I was wondering whether MCDOT was looking into those kinds of solutions to pair with the actual infrastructure.
That's also a great question. The automated enforcement in Montgomery County is done by the Montgomery County Police Department. So that is something that we can certainly reach out to them about, but they tend to make those decisions based on observed bad behavior. So on a project like this, where we're kind of changing things, there would not be a history of bad behavior that would maybe warrant the installation of a camera under the way they typically do things. It's certainly a conversation that we can have with them, but they typically want to target the areas where in the county where there are really major problems to focus on. So when you have really chronic speeding, for example, in a particular area, that's where they want to focus on putting speed cameras. Certainly something to think about. I just can't make any promises since that's something that's outside of the purview of DOT.
That makes sense. Thanks for explaining that. The last thing that I wanted to mention real quick is I wanted to strongly encourage MCDOT not to consider on-street parking at all when designing these plans. I think that 4,000 spots in parking garages located within a block of Fenton Street sounds like plenty of parking to me, and I want MCDOT to focus exclusively on safety. And you know, I would hate for MCDOT to sacrifice you know, safety to accommodate on-street parking, especially when it seems like there's so much excess already.
Well, what I will say is that safety is our highest priority, and it is the thing that we are most focused on ensuring happens here is safety. So if there's an issue where parking blocks sight lines or something, we absolutely will remove that parking to make it safer for pedestrians and cyclists. But there is a role for parking on Fenton Street, and I think the balance is figuring out exactly how much parking and loading we need. But there is, I think, a need for at least some level of parking on street. So we can certainly look through that more as we go through the design process. And I know that you've been engaged for the past several months in this process, and I'm sure you're going to continue to be engaged. So we look forward to continuing that discussion going forward. Was that it for you, Zachary?
Yes, that's it. Thank you, Matt.
Okay. Thank you very much. If you don't mind muting yourself and lowering your hand, and I'm going to call on Ansel Torres. I think I just asked you to unmute, but right as I clicked it, it moved. So let me try again. So Ansel, you should be able to unmute yourself now.
Yes, hello?
Yeah, go ahead, Ansel.
Yes. I just wanted to echo some comments that I made in the room, the downtown Silver Spring room. I have been a frequent critic of MCDOT. I am totally blind, and I live on Rota Road and frequently walk between Rota and Thayer, by where the Safeway is. And it was very encouraging and reassuring to see that there was actually a study that looked into the needs of people who are visually impaired walking that particular part of Fenton Street, because it was almost like the study was designed to study my particular issues. I know that wasn't the case, of course, but it was very reassuring to see that happening. And I made some comments at previous meetings, and it was again reassuring, especially on the floating bus stops and the bikes and slowing the bikes down at the intersections where blind folks have to cross. And one of the ideas I introduced was the speed bump, and maybe other people introduced talked about it as well. And I'm glad to hear in your presentation that it appears that that was included. I have a question about the, I think that you said that there was something that is going to be done at Ellsworth and Fenton as far as keeping or helping blind folks to stay on the crosswalk. Was it a tactile thing that you're talking about? What was that?
Yeah, that's correct. We are proposing to have a tactile treatment inside the roadway on either side of the crosswalk, so that if you're walking in the crosswalk and you start to wander out of the crosswalk, you'll should be able to feel it with your feet, and with a cane, if you use a cane, you should be able to feel
that's it. That almost that, when I heard that, I was like, oh my god, they were thinking about me on this one, because I have, because of all the distractions, I have actually walked out onto Fenton Street as a result of all the noise that's there, and that's why it is of major concern to me. So having that tactile thing there would absolutely address my issue, and I am really, really, really excited to hear about that part. That was just brilliant, I think. One of the things that was mentioned about something I said in the meeting was about closing the entire Ellsworth strip. I was the one that was suggesting, but I wasn't suggesting closing all of Ellsworth in that, you know, at Fenton. I was just talking about closing the intersection, because obviously there's a garage there, and if all of Ellsworth is closed, then you can't. What is that? I think that's an exit. You can't exit onto Ellsworth there. So definitely don't want to close all of Ellsworth, but certainly the intersection where a lot of the buskers like to perform, and the county seems to like to have them there, and MCDOT wants to have them there, and never mind blind folks are distracted by it. Certainly I am distracted by it and have difficulty navigating, and it definitely interferes with my safety. And so I'm glad that efforts are being made in that direction, and hopefully maybe that's something that could be considered if at all possible. One other thing I want to mention has to do with, I think it was a suggestion made for some reason for making the sidewalk a level with the street. I don't know if it was at an intersection or the whole sidewalk or whatever. I don't know how other blind folks think about this, but having the street the same level as the sidewalk it does not feel safe for me as a blind person. There's actually an example of that right at the, I believe it's the southwest intersection of Fenton and Colesville, right there by the mall. It is flat there, and my doctor is on that side. I used to on the other side of Fenton, the other side of Colesville, going down to Cameron. I used to go to the gym there. So I would cross that street a lot, but I would never cross on that side, where the sidewalk is even with the rope, simply because even though there are tactile things there, basically you have to concentrate real hard to know when you have actually gotten onto the sidewalk. So, you know, you stop walking briskly. So if I'm crossing and I don't have a place to sort of tap my cane and encounter a sidewalk where I either have to walk up gradually or lift my feet to get up on the sidewalk, it actually is difficult. When you're crossing, it's sort of a nerve-wracking thing sometimes for me, especially on a very wide road like Colesville. So yes, and the tactile is there, but it's not enough to let me know that, hey, you don't have to keep running, so you don't have to keep walking so fast. You've already crossed and you're on the sidewalk. I always cross on the other side of that intersection. That is the, I guess that would be the east side of the intersection. And my wife actually is also blind and she feels the same way. So we never cross there. So I think making the roadway, even with the sidewalk, at least from my perspective and that of my wife, it doesn't feel so safe. So those are my comments. And thank you for the time.
Of course.
Thank you. Hey, Matt, I can jump in there. That was probably something I said earlier. Just to clarify, the sidewalk, elevation of the sidewalk wouldn't change. It's the cycle track that in certain locations, like floating bus stops and possibly, you know, near intersections, would be raised and flush or close to flush with the sidewalk. And we're looking at, you know, what type of treatments could be used, you know, whether they're tactile strips or whatever to differentiate the sidewalk between the cycle track, not the roadway, not the vehicular portion of the roadway.
All right. Well, thanks for that clarification.
And thank you, Ansel. I know you've been involved with our vision impaired study, and I appreciate all the feedback you've given us. So keep the good comments coming. So Cindy, I'm going to ask you to unmute yourself, Cindy Buddington. I apologize last time, right as I clicked unmute on Ansel, the list scrolled up and I hit it on you instead. So I apologize. Go ahead and speak.
Okay,
speak,
not a problem. Just a couple of quick things. Just for people who don't know me, I use a wheelchair. And so I find some of the like brick pavers, I don't know if they're only there for decoration, so to speak. I'm not sure if they're that tactile for blind people or low vision. And I don't like them. They're too bumpy and they kind of shift my balance in the wheelchair. The other thing on that a little bit is, you know, for somebody who, you know, not only uses a wheelchair, but maybe a cane or a walker, parents with strollers, you know, it again depends on how well they're built and how well they're maintained can cause problems. The other thing was when it came to parking, street parking, you know, there are a number of people, again, whether it's a disability or as we get older, we walk less distance-wise. So, so I like some street parking. I think that's important. And then I used to drive and I had a wheelchair lift equipped full-size van with a raised roof. And again, you know, you couldn't park it in a parking garage. So depending upon how you built those parking garages in Silver Spring, they may not be usable for people, you know, needing shorter distance to go to a store or to carry their products to and from, you know, to carry a bag of, I don't know, bag of groceries and have to wheel it or walk it with a walker, you know, two blocks is a lot more difficult than carrying it, you know, basically to the closest street parking. So just, again, I guess it's a little bit of education for people that don't have disabilities to know some of our challenges. And again, you know, I really enjoy the fact that the people in the group said they were either bicyclists or they had a disability and what their disability was, or if they were one of the, you know, MDOT people. So I thank everybody for that. And I think that's basically, you know, really all my questions right now or comments right now. But again, to just say thank you very much for all the work everybody's doing, you know, Matt, and for all the citizens that are putting their input into it. And that's it.
Okay, thank you very much, Cindy, and we appreciate all the time you've taken to give us feedback. Cindy was actually in one of our focus groups for the low vision study that we did to make sure that the treatments that we're doing to try and help low vision people get around don't negatively impact people who use wheelchairs or other mobility assistant devices. So we have a lot of work to do to make the county more accessible. And that's something that we're absolutely committed to working on. And we really appreciate all the feedback that we're getting from you and the other stakeholders. So thank you for that. I'm gonna go ahead and mute you and lower your hand. And I'm gonna call on the phone number ending in, 5301. I'm gonna ask you to unmute yourself. Phone number ending in 5301. And I believe *6 will unmute yourself. Try dialing *6. Phone number ending in 5301. Can you try dialing *6? Okay, well, we are gonna, we'll come back to you and we'll see if you've managed to get yourself unmuted. I'm gonna go ahead and looks like you got yourself unmuted. Go ahead.
This is Brett Roulier, can you hear me?
Yes, I can, go ahead.
Oh, okay, so I have quite a few comments, but I'll narrow them down and I'll write in the rest of them. One is that I understand there's gonna be a minimum 5 foot wide par that you're going to try and attain throughout the corridor.
I'm sorry, 5 foot wide what?
Pedestrian accessible route.
Oh, it will be minimum of 5 feet wide. We hope it'll be largely wider, but it will be at least 5 feet wide.
Although that's much appreciated, certainly for like a lively, active commercial area, 5 foot, you know, is a pretty narrow target to meet. I understand we have a lot of a lot of width issues here, but 5 foot does really compromise pedestrian traffic.
Yeah. So just to be clear, we are shooting for much wider, and that at pinch points we expect 5 feet to be the absolute minimum. So we're not even proposing to have pinch points that are less than 5 feet. So the point that we wanted to make was that there will be at least a 5 foot continuous uninterrupted path so that you can basically go as straight as possible and avoid any signal cabinets or utility poles or fire hydrants or sidewalk cafes. But that there may be places where the sidewalk is significantly wider than that, but there will be at least a 5 foot wide path. We do have a lot of limitations in this area. There are places where we really can't get any wider. Or we might have to remove a sidewalk cafe, which is not something that we want to do. We know these are really popular areas. It's early in the design process. That's a good comment, but I would say that most of the corridor has more than 5 foot wide sidewalks. We're just talking about 5 feet in pinch points.
And this is going to be a linear path, right? You don't have to walk around poles and light poles.
Correct. That's the goal, is to have as direct a path as possible.
Okay. I'm asking that you be more aggressive in using all your right-of-way that you have. I do notice that areas that a lot of property owners have built, you know, fencing around their properties, and like at the Exxon station across from the Safeway, they've built these huge brick piers that extend out into the public right-of-way. I'm not sure if you're planning to remove them, but they're certainly, they're certainly imposing upon this pedestrian path we're trying to create. So if you could kind of, you know, reclaim your right of way, I think it would give you a little more area to work with.
Yeah, there are some areas where it may appear to be right of way, but it actually is not owned by the county. There are some places where the right of way gets as narrow as 64 feet. So I think, for example, at Cafe Le Sac, that area where the sidewalk cafe is actually not right of way, I believe. I believe that's on private property that was never acquired.
Right.
In terms of the Exxon station, I think you mentioned those brick columns were actually installed by the county as part of the streetscaping project back in the early 2000s. So those are probably on county right of way, but they were installed by the county, not by Exxon. So I don't want anyone to think we're accusing Exxon of taking over the right of way. Those were actually installed by the county. But that is something that's a good comment. We can look at whether those still need to be there or if that's something that we can work on. And I think those might have actually been installed to kind of keep vehicles off the sidewalk, you know, to keep vehicles from encroaching from the parking area and onto the sidewalk. So they do serve a purpose, but there might be a better way to do that while accommodating more pedestrian space.
And at the Safeway right across the street, they have a very huge wide driveway to enter in off of Fenton. And at least a third of that, the Safeway itself has blocked off with this huge brick planter. So a third of that driveway is not even accessible to the driveway. So I don't see why you can't reduce that curb width. I know this comment was made before and they said they couldn't reduce these curb widths, but there's certainly some locations, you know, and the Safeway is a great example where it can be reduced because they reduced it themselves already.
Yeah, well, we can absolutely look at that. I think one of the challenges with Safeway is that it's not just a parking garage entrance. It's also where their loading dock is. They do need a lot of maneuvering space for the tractor trailers that back in from Fenton Street. I think, you know, one way to solve that is if the Safeway ever redevelops. You know, Wheaton's Safeway redeveloped a couple of years ago. There might be opportunities to rethink the way loading happens there. But I think short of a redevelopment, we are kind of stuck with what we have. And that's kind of the nature of things. Sometimes decisions are made 40 years ago and we're still living with the consequences of those decisions. And I think the decision to design the Safeway that way may have seemed logical. And I'm not sure exactly when it was built, but I'm just going to say 1980. But it's something that causes problems now. And I know that there are decisions that we're making now that a planner 40 years from now might criticize me for making. But we are really trying to make improvements here, and we are willing to look at changes, and we can certainly work with Safeway. That is one of the businesses we have met with in person.
If what they need is a radius, then you need to install a radius, you know, that's clear to the public, the pedestrian, and the tractor trailer is trying to back him back and drive out, which they don't have. I mean, it's like I said, what they have now is you have this huge wide curb cut that leads into a brick wall practically. And that's not how it should be designed. And since you're redesigning all this, you can take care of it now and still accommodate their tractor trailer needs.
We have about 5 minutes left and we still have 3 more people with hands up. So did you have any other comments, Brett?
Yes, I did. I'm to understand that at least alongside these floating bus islands, you're going to have the bike ways, the cycle track is going to be raised to the level of the sidewalk?
What we are proposing is that there would be one level crossing, which is essentially a speed hump at one of the crossings, and that otherwise the bike lane would be channelized, meaning that it would be at the same elevation as the roadway. So what that means is, and there's a lot that we can still work out through the design process, so this
I know what that means.
Well, just in case anyone else who's listening doesn't know what that means. If you're biking at street level, when you get to the unsignalized crosswalk, you would go up to sidewalk level, go across the crosswalk, and then go back down to street level. And then at the signalized crosswalk, you would be channelized at street elevation where pedestrians are crossing over that signalized crosswalk. So that's kind of how we're thinking about designing them now based on our low vision study that we did. That's kind of how we found the consensus around that from the blind community was, and also accommodating wheelchair users. But go ahead with your other comments.
The last thing I'd like to mention is that the way this is designed, when there's a snow event, all the snow is going to be plowed on top of these floating islands. I'm not sure what you propose to do about managing the snow removal off the islands.
Yeah, we have an urban district in Silver Spring that I think does a lot of work in this area. And typically in major snow events, we don't plow the snow so much as we use backhoes to put it in dump trucks and take it away, because there's nowhere to put the snow. So we do have floating bus stops in Silver Spring already, and we haven't had any really major snow events since those were installed, because I think the last blizzard we had was like in 2016. But, right. But when we have those major snow events, the snow is not plowed. It is initially plowed, but then we come through and collect it and take it away, because otherwise it would take forever to melt. So that is something that we're aware of. We're going to continue to work on figuring out how that works. And if we need to make tweaks in our procedures, we certainly will do that. All right, okay. We're almost out of time. So I want to go ahead and move on to Rush Seal. I'm asking you to unmute yourself.
Yeah, hi. So, and I'll try to be pretty quick here. And so, I mean, I guess in general, and I know that I was the one who asked about the Grove versus Fenton, and they're saying about how Fenton is more of like a, for cyclists who are commuting. And just from, you know, my younger son was hit by a cyclist in DC. And so I have a lot of concerns about cyclists going quickly and speeding through things. And I realize that there's other concerns with other vehicles too, but just that cyclists can also cause injuries and not be paying attention. And so just very concerned about fast moving cyclists going through. But specifically on the GIST, on the 410 Fenton crossing, just wanted to mention that because we both drive and walk often, and so when we're driving, we use that a lot. Having it where it's very easy to get onto that bridge is very, very important to us. And also, I cross over there with my young kids all the time. And what we have found, at least from our 9 years of walking with our kids there, is that the cars have been very considerate about stopping for us when crossing. So just want to just kind of advocate for having the cars be able to easily get on to the 410 crossing, and that from my experience, they've been very considerate to pedestrians.
Yeah, thanks for that feedback. I will just say, related to your first point with safety, you're absolutely correct that safety is important, not only for drivers to watch out for people, but also for cyclists to do so. I just want to point out that this project is entirely about improving safety for both pedestrians and cyclists. So narrowing the roadway, we will make drivers go more slowly in these areas. It will reduce the crossing distance. Yes, there'll be bikes here, but we also are installing countermeasures to try and reduce their speeds in certain areas. But we all have to share the space, and we really are committed to making sure that everyone gets through here safely and comfortably. I'm going to go ahead and go on to Gray Kimbrough. I'm asking you to unmute yourself, Gray. Go ahead.
Hi. Yeah, I have a couple of things. So I have young children who are starting to bike, and it is incredibly important to me that we have protected lanes on Fenton for them to be able to bike. I would not feel comfortable with my 7-year-old biking down Fenton right now, but she would be fine in a protected lane. I want to also emphasize that so as you've mentioned in the plans, this would presumably be a continuous protected concrete barrier, hopefully unlike the one on Wayne, where there are gaps and it doesn't always go all the way to the intersections. So I hope that this will be an improved barrier. I've seen them elsewhere in Silver Spring. Hopefully that will carry over. I'd like to learn more about how there are going to be treatments at curb cuts. We've talked about treatments for bikers to make sure they're aware of those with disabilities at the floating bike lanes. We haven't talked a lot about treatments to make drivers aware of bikers and those crossing at these many curb cuts, and especially as you have said that you intend to maintain as many curb cuts as possible, but also that safety is a priority. I'd like to hear a lot more about how you're going to be painting those green, you're going to be putting up signs for the drivers, you're going to be putting down treatments that make it clear to drivers that there is a crossing there and there are people that they could definitely hit when they pull out. And so I really want to hear a lot more about that. Another thing that I'd like to hear more about is the intersection at Wayne with the purple line and those tracks. It has this weird jog in the crossing. I'm not sure how that's going to work. And so we need to hear a lot more about how that's exactly going to work. And my last thing is you've said that safety is a huge priority along this corridor. I know that MCDOT has been piloting a 20 mile per hour speed limit in various places in the county. This will be a great place to pilot a 20 mile per hour speed limit as we're seeking to calm that traffic, make things safer for drivers, pedestrians, and bikers. Let's also lower the speed limit along the stretch. Thank you.
Those are great points. I'll try and answer them as best I can. So in terms of the driveway crossings, yeah, absolutely something we need to work some more on, things that we are going to work through on design. We don't entirely know answers to, but I will say that the raised speed tables could be an option, so that drivers do have to kind of go up and over, as well as cyclists having to go up and over, which is what we've installed on the Capitol Crescent Surface Trail in Bethesda on Bethesda Avenue. So if you have a chance to swing by Bethesda sometime, we have the bike lane is not open yet, but you can see the speed tables. They're located on Bethesda Avenue between Woodmont and Wisconsin, and they serve the circle that serves the I can't really address the numbers, but basically across the street from the old Jimmy John's there, and also the loading dock for that same building, which is where the Chase Bank is. In terms of the Wayne Avenue crossing, the concept plans show kind of an angular crossing. It's not really going to be that angular, but the point of that is to make sure that when cyclists cross the light rail tracks, that they cross as close to 90 degrees as possible. There's a great example in Seattle. I think it's at 7th Avenue and Westlake in Seattle, where they have a streetcar, and Westlake is kind of a diagonal street in Seattle. And they, in the bike lane, you follow the bike lanes, and it has a little bit of an S curve as you go through the intersection to make sure that cyclists cross over the light rail tracks at as close to 90 degrees as possible. That being said, there will be flangeway fillers in the purple line tracks in the intersection. So the risk of getting your wheel caught in the streetcar tracks should be lower, but we still want to encourage people to learn to cross at close to 90 degrees, because there may be other instances in the future where they're crossing tracks that don't have a flangeway filler. I actually saw in a different city, but I saw a cyclist riding parallel to streetcar tracks inadvertently kind of stray into the streetcar zone and run right into get his wheels right in the flangeway, and crashed immediately. So this is something that we want to make sure that we are, because the tracks are curved here and they're entering the intersection at a 45 degree angle, there's a lot of design work that we need to do, but there is going to be some kind of a jog. Exactly what that looks like will be worked out as we go through the design process, and is also subject to approval by the Maryland State Highway Administration and the Maryland Transit Administration, since it's the Purple Line tracks are involved. We have one hand left up, and there were a couple of questions that came in on the chat, so I'm going to call on Dan, and then I'm going to try and just answer a few of the questions in the chat, and then we'll be done. So before that, and we may start losing people, we've already started losing some people, so before I get to Dan's question, I just want to thank everyone for coming out tonight. I hope you'll stick with us for the rest of this, but I know we're a little bit over time, and you all have very busy lives. I know that you could have been doing a lot tonight, besides attending a community meeting like this. So I really appreciate the fact that you all took the time to come and give us feedback and help us make this project better. So with that, I am asking you to unmute yourself, Dan, and go ahead and ask your question or give us your comment.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Matt. So my name is Dan Garrett. I'm a property owner of a multi-story building with tenants and the property manager, and also a longtime cyclist. I'm a member of WABA for dating back to the 70s. One of the meetings I did talk to Peter Gray. I've heard, I think it's great, and I welcome the comments that we've heard from both residents and from cyclists. I haven't heard from any of the business owners. Partly I know with our tenants, they're minority owned small businesses. They're struggling, obviously, coming out of COVID. So some of the issues that have been brought up, and I just wanted to make sure, Matt, you were aware of these, the discussions of loading areas is very important because there are deliveries that are being made to our tenants, including, you know, the liquor deliveries that need to be made that can't be, you know, 2 miles away to try to do a delivery of heavy goods. And also because both, and this also applies to residential areas, you know, we also have building repairs, and it's not really feasible to say that a plumber or an HVAC is going to park blocks and blocks away or park in the parking garage when there's heavy tools to be delivered and equipment. So that's something to be aware of, Matt, that there has to be areas right now when we need repairs done to our building, they park on Fenton, and there's two sides of the street to park on, and they might be there for hours. So I know sometimes cyclists tend to forget and say, hey, you can just walk. What's the big deal? You can park, and there's 4,000 parking spaces. But a lot of those parking spaces are taken up by not people visiting the businesses. They might be residents. They might be employees. It's something to consider. And also the elderly who aren't disabled like me. I mean, sometimes it's hard to say, yeah, you're going to walk blocks at night in Silver Spring and you're going to park in an underground parking garage like lot 3. It's not always the safest thing. I don't know if people have been there when they're not biking at night. It's a concern we have for our tenants. And, you know, if you run a hair salon, you want to have somebody be able to be parking close by, not having to park on the third story of a building and then having to walk blocks. But I encourage, you know, Matt, you talked about talking to property owners to do the walking around that somebody suggested. LASEC, as you mentioned, that is part of our building. So they do have that area up front. And we've taken a lot of steps to beautify that area with planters and planter boxes to make it look nice. So the comments that I've heard about having bike parking, I highly encourage that. Otherwise, if you don't do that, these businesses are not going to survive. And we'll have a beautiful bike path, which I'll enjoy, but we'll be going by empty storefronts because they're not going to survive if there's no place to park. And if you have people bike, there has to be places for people to park their bikes. They can't just, you know, they're not the residents. So that's really my comments. I appreciate it. I know this is running late, but I welcome feedback and I welcome us working with business owners, working with WABA and working with you guys to get feedback from people like us who, and our tenants who tend to be pretty busy just trying to keep their head above water. So thank you.
Yeah, Dan, those are great points. And we actually have done corridor walks. We've done, I think, 3 corridor walks where we've actually gone out, talked to businesses in front of their businesses, gone into their businesses, walked with them. Cafe LaSac, we actually went in and sat at one of their tables and talked to the owner for a while. In terms of parking, you're right. There absolutely is a need for people to park, whether they're elderly or disabled. But the problem is, right now, we don't guarantee that the spaces are available. Like, you may need to park in front of the business, and they're all taken by people who maybe don't need to park there. So the question, I think, is, you know, how do we manage it so that the spaces are available for the people who need them when they need them? And the people who have the ability to walk further, that we encourage them to walk further so that those spaces are available for the people who really do need them. So I think that's a great point. I think the point about the renovations and the repairs is a good one, you know, that we may need to have some long-term, that's not really loading exactly, but that is a need. You know, how do we accommodate that? I think that's a great point and something that we are gonna take into consideration and try and figure out how to accommodate that. This corridor is, we have a lot of work to do, not only with the design, but also with policy, to work with our parking team to make sure that we can design something that really does meet the needs of now and not necessarily the needs of 20 years ago or 30 years ago. And so we got a lot of work to do, and I hope that you're along for the ride on this one and that you're going to be at the future meetings, and that goes for all of you. I really do appreciate the feedback. I'm just going to go quickly through the chats and try and address those. We got a couple of questions. Then I do apologize. We had some technical difficulties with the captioning in the downtown room. Just making sure. I know we had a question about bricks being slippery. We are proposing to largely have the pedestrian access route be concrete because it is smoother and sturdier and has more traction, but that we would use bricks for accents and other border areas. That's kind of what we're thinking right now. That's something that we can certainly consider as we go through the design process. Just trying to make sure I get all of the questions here. There was a concern that the bike lanes on Spring Street and Cedar Street are narrow and have a lot of debris and people encroaching in them. So, and this is more of a question, are we going to do anything on Spring Street? I think it's more of a question, are we going to do anything on Spring Street? But in terms of how those similar issues might impact Fenton Street, I mean, we will not have parking directly adjacent to the bike lane here. So the dooring issue should be less of a concern. In terms of the debris issue, I think we're trying to design this to have the highest quality and that we might be trying to move some of the drainage. So the drainage is not running across the bike lane to get to the curb, but rather is draining into those bioswales or planter boxes in between the bike lane and the roadway. So certainly things that we're looking at, and that's an excellent point. And I think I got all of the comments in the, I think I got all the points in the chat. So I appreciate everyone for coming out tonight. I know that we've had a lot of meetings on this, and some of you have been with us since the very beginning, so I really appreciate that. But even if it's your first time, welcome to this process. I hope it's not your last time. I hope that we see you a lot more at these future meetings. Thank you again for coming out this evening and spending a little over 2 hours with us. I look forward to seeing you in person, hopefully, at our next meeting this fall. And I guess I'll let you all sign off now, but thank you very much, and we look forward to working with you over the next couple months.